Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Saints of Salvation by Peter F. Hamilton, narrated by John Lee. Juloss Falling. Ahead of the Nayana insertion ship, Juloss glowed like a sapphire pearl, its vast oceans and small continents wrapped in long, tranquil streamers of cloud. Space around it was speckled with diamond dust glimmers as sunlight bounced off the orbital forts that guarded this precious world against invasion. The insertion ship flew in south of the ecliptic, shedding cold mass in irregular bursts like a black comet. By the time it was on its final approach to the unsuspecting planet, it was down to 25 meters in diameter. It had no magnetic field, and its outer shell was radiation absorbent, rendering it invisible. Fully stealthed, it eluded the vigilance of the orbital forts to slip past them, discarding the last of its reaction mass in its final deceleration maneuver. Now it was basically falling toward the western edge of the largest continent, where a tall mountain range sank into the sea. Tiny course correction ejector continued to refine the ship's descent vector, steering it toward the coast, which was still 30 minutes from greeting the dawn. Inland, perched on undulating foothills, lights from the lonely city of Ephrata shone brightly across the lush valley. As it hit the upper atmosphere, the insertion ship peeled apart into six pear-shaped segments. They plunged downward, aero breaking with increasing severity as the atmosphere thickened around them. The segments were aimed close to a thin spit of land whose rocky coastline was covered in a tangle of vegetation. 100 meters from the shore, six large splash plumes shot up into the air like thick geysers, crowning and splattering down amidst the startled seabirds flying out to catch the first fish of the day. The Nayana swam ashore, creatures out of every human's dark ancestral nightmare, risen out of banishment to stalk the land once more, formidable reptilian bodies moving fast on multiple sinewy limbs, razor claws snapping continuously. They climbed the cliffs at the foot of the mountains and set off in search of their prey. Delian knew the Nayana pack was closing on him. He was in Ephrata's downtown district, lurking in the shadows of a deserted plaza as the hot sun shone down vertically. The creepers that were colonizing the lower floors of the crystal and carbon skyscrapers trailed long strands like a verdant waterfall. It was good cover. He stole through the dangling vegetation, letting their silky leaves slither over his bare face, a sensation akin to a shower of fine dust. Somewhere along the avenue he was approaching, a flock of birds took flight, wings pumping hard to create a swirl of bright colors, blotting out the sky. He peered forward, seeing long shadows slink between the ferns that had conquered the pavements. A fast clattering was just audible above the dumb squawking of the fleeing birds, the gullet rattle Nayana packs used to communicate when they were hunting. Delian spun around the corner of the building, raising his bow. The lead Nayana was closer than he would have liked. When the diabolical thing saw him, it started a kill run. Muscles as thick as his torso flexed along its hind limbs, pounding it forward. Two sets of upper body limbs extended, claws snapping. Its victorious ululation was deafening. Delian stood still for a second, keeping the bow stable. He let the iron-tipped arrow fly. It split the air like a black laser beam and pierced Nayana's gullet. The monster lurched to the ground, bile-colored blood pumping from the wound, momentum tumbling it forward. The others screamed their fury and charged him, but Delian was already gone, racing for the other side of the avenue and the tangle of creepers skirting the skyscraper. Dappled darkness closed around him, and the rough leaves clung to his bulky, bulletproof vest, slowing his flight. His boots crunched the fronds beneath his feet as he headed for cover behind the skyscraper's entrance portico. Behind him, the Nayana were calling to one another, their stark twig drum rattle reverberating across the plaza. He reached the portico and crouched down. His breathing was heavy in his ears, heart pounding as he waited, but nothing attacked him. He eased his metal helmet up a fraction and snuck a quick glance around the wall. Two of the Nayana were stalking along his side of the plaza, with three more scouring the buildings beyond the central fountain pond. Delian gripped his assault rifle tightly and slowly moved clear of the portico, dependent on just a few wispy vines to shield him from the aliens. He brought the muzzle up and opened fire in a blaze of flame and thunderous noise. Recoil hammered into his shoulder, but he kept his aim steady and watched the slugs tear a line through the first Nayana's flesh. The one behind it hesitated, as if cowed by the violence. Then it pulled what looked like a bazooka out of its harness. "Fucking saints!" Delian yelled. He sprinted forward, firing as he went, spraying bullets in the general direction of the second Nayana. The creature fired its weapon, and the portico exploded behind him. A blast wave slammed into him, sending him sprawling. The armor suit's reactive carapace absorbed the brunt of the force while he curled up to roll through the impact. Adaptive musculature brought him back up to his feet fast, and sensor graphics swept across his optic, tracking enemy targets. The micro-missile launch pod snapped up out of his backpack, ready for acquisition data. Four Nayana were powering into the plaza, wearing gray carbon exoskeletons with multiple weapon attachments. Electronic warfare systems went active, blitzing the plaza in a digital haze. Delian was about to fire his missiles when the sky overhead began to brighten. His sensor view flipped to vertical. High above, a brilliant golden fireball was punching down through the atmosphere, a rigid amber pillar of overheated air stretching out behind it. He took an instinctive step backward as the fireball seemed to accelerate. Its radiance flooded the plaza, turning his vision monochrome. Oh, crap. He turned to run. The fireball struck the fountain, and light detonated out, overwhelming everything. Delian blinked the glare away and stared through the high fence that guarded the perimeter of the Umerli estate. 25 kilometers away, on the other side of the jungle-clad valley, Ephrata shone like the sun, every building gleaming as if it contained a solar flare. He shrugged and jogged on toward the sports field where his year group should be waiting. They were due to play a soccer match against the Ansaru clan that afternoon. Personally, Delian couldn't wait another 8 months until they all reached their 10th birthday, when Alexandra had promised him that they could start training in the orbital arena. He just loved the idea of them flying around in zero-G, somersaulting in slow-mo, bouncing off walls to soar like a bird. A locak screeched out its hunting cry. Delian stopped again, scanning the fence. That had sounded very close.
"There's nothing there, you know."
He spun around to see Yurella standing behind him. But this Yurella was fully grown, easily twice his height, and she didn't have hair anymore. Even so, she was wearing a t-shirt and sports shorts, just like him. Yurella always did join the boys on the pitch to play their games, unlike Tiliana and Elise. He gawped at her for a moment. Somehow, this older Yurella was even more captivating than the one he knew, although he knew this one as well.
"I don't understand."
"Then what was that sound?" he asked, smug that he'd outsmarted her, of all people.
"A memory."
She went down on her knees, putting her big head level with his, and held both hands toward him.
"Do you trust me, Del?"
Outside the fence, a whole chorus of low-cack screeches began, rising in pitch and ferocity. He knew that meant they were gathering, ready to assault the estate at the bidding of the Nayana. Always the Nayana, the eternal enemy, tricksters and betrayers.
"Yes,"
Delian said nervously, trying to look at her and not out at the tangled jungle beyond the fence.
"Good."
She took his hands. Her fingers were cool and dry and immensely strong. Yurella's presence always made him content, but this time the physical touch was profound. It wasn't just his skin that was feeling her. The sensation of touch was sinking deep into his flesh, cooling and relaxing his muscles. He hadn't realized he was so tense.
"This is important, Del. None of this, what you're seeing, the estate, Juloss, none of it is real."
"What?" He turned his head a fraction.
"No. Look at me, Del." Keep looking.
Her eyes were wide with love and concern. The emotion was so strong that it was all he could do just to stop his eyes from watering.
I don't understand, he said miserably.
There is one thing I know you do understand.
I am here, Del. I am with you, and I will never leave you. Not ever. Because I love you.
The world behind her was vibrating, as if he were shaking his head frantically. But he wasn't. No way could he shift his gaze from her beautiful eyes.
This is like a game, Del. I want you to play it with me. Will you do that?
Yes,
he whispered, scared now. The world was shaking so badly he didn't know why he couldn't feel it.
There are bad things out there.
But they're not the beasts we were always warned about. These bad things are like nightmare monsters, and they invade your head to fill it with really evil ideas. But I'm here with you now, so together we can fight them off.
I don't want to fight.
I want to go home.
We are home, Del. That's why we're here in the estate. This is so you, the very start of you.
So fundamental that they can't corrupt it like everything else.
You belong here.
Yes.
So we have to take away the abuse they're suffocating you in. Do you remember your year group?
Yes.
They're your squad now, aren't they?
He closed his eyes briefly, seeing the laughing faces of his year group, their features distorting as if they were reflecting off a buckled mirror, changing and aging. Except,
Rello,
he groaned as his friend's face blackened, cracks splitting open to ooze slimy blood before the vision shrank away to nothing.
I know,
Yrella said gently.
He's gone.
We killed him. It's our fault.
We're nothing more than prisoners.
They chained us at birth. Nobody chained us, Delian. We're free.
No.
It's the saints.
They did this to us. They took away our choice. He snarled.
I'm glad they're dead.
What?
He stared at her shocked face.
I'm glad,
he told her truthfully. The world around them stopped shaking. A reassuring grey crept into the colours, toning down the harshness of the tropical landscape. The so-called saints had been killed. He remembered seeing it so vividly. The Olyix had shared their memory of the time when the revered salvation of life had arrived back at the Gateway star system. The avenging heretic, the saint's stolen transport ship, which had stowed away on board the arkship for the whole voyage home, had made a sudden dash for freedom, shooting without warning at the harmless Olyix ships nearby. They had no choice but to regretfully return fire, just to protect themselves from such senseless aggression. It remained so vivid in his mind, exploding in nuclear violence, its radiance shimmering off the Gateway's opalescent splendor. So painful, knowing how much he had been lied to.
Damn it!
Yrella snapped.
That memory route left you open. Sorry, my fault. Delian, focus, please. Focus on me.
He smiled weakly at her as the greyness grew around them.
I love you, Delian. Do you remember that?
Of course I do.
They kissed as the greyness eclipsed the universe, and they fell into the orbital arena. A place he adorned. Such a simple place. A padded cylinder, 70 meters long with a diameter of 100. Above him, drifting through the air, were 30 hurdles. Hazard orange polyhedrons, as familiar as star formations in the night. Oh, the games they'd played in here. The fun. The wins and losses. And so early on he'd broken every rule to attack another boy who was going to hurt Yrella.
Oh, yes.
He exhaled, and when he looked at Yrella, she was sharing the thrill of all those memories that came swirling out of their shared youth. Then she let go.
No!
He exclaimed. Still smiling, she fell away from him. The arena wall behind her attenuated, showing him Juloss far below. It was under attack. Thousands of big Olyix resolution ships raced in toward it, glowing hazy amber as they cut through the upper atmosphere at terrific velocity. Mushroom clouds seethed upward from the surface as cities and estates were obliterated.
No! He yelled. This is not what happened! The Olyix are our friends!
They didn't do this! I've got the flagpole!
Urella shouted back joyfully. I'm going for the goal hoop! Delian squinted, seeing her in a protective bodysuit, grinning wildly as she clutched the flashing flagball. The opposing team's goal hoop hung in space, halfway toward the burning planet. The speed she was traveling at was frightening. Careful, he said. She laughed delightedly, on course to score the winning goal. He didn't see the number 8 player streaking toward her, except it wasn't the number 8 anymore. It was an Olyix hunt sphere accelerating hard, targeting systems aligning on Urella's lanky body as she flew effortlessly toward the goal hoop. No! Delian cried. His armor suit powered him toward the hunt sphere. He struck it hard, knocking it off course. His talon-tipped gauntlets scrabbled against the shiny sphere, scoring long marks in the tough shell. Then it began to flex, with bulges pushing up, as if whatever it contained were trying to reach out and wrestle with him. He strengthened his hold, attempting to crush it in his arms. The sphere responded by softening against his chest, letting him merge inward. He would fit it perfectly, he knew. Ahead of them, Juloss split open, revealing the end of the universe, where the silver remnants of stars formed elegant rivers of twilight and fell into the nothingness at the heart. Beside it, a golden light was shining, calling him onward. Urella landed on the surface of the hunt sphere, legs apart, ebony skin alive, with scarlet hieroglyphs.
This is going to hurt, she said sternly. What? Ye don't...
Somehow Delian was looking down on himself, the hunt sphere, with Urella balancing perfectly on him, reaching down. Her hand punctured the shell, and the pain was incredible. His scream made the dying universe tremble. The damage she'd caused had opened up long cracks in the sphere. She tore at them, prying up jagged sections and sending them spinning off into the void. He began to struggle, writhing frantically to escape her merciless fingers.
Trust me, she said. Don't fight this, Del. I'm stripping out the neurovirus. What?
He was sobbing now. The pain was so intense, burning along every nerve to punish his quaking brain.
I love you, Del. You know that. Nothing can take that out of you. Yes. Then say it, she demanded. I love you.
Her hands ripped apart the last of the hunt sphere shell to reveal his Olyix quint body.
I can't be that, he wailed. I love you, Del. Forever. No matter where that takes us. Help me, he pleaded.
The end of the universe was curving around them, its final fragments forming a fetid vortex that was pulling them down into the death of eternity and the golden god at its side, the one waiting for them. Urella's hand sliced into the quint flesh. Delian felt fingers closing around his arm. She pulled. Quint flesh stretched like slippery rubber, clinging to him, merging to give him strength. Now he was struggling against it, the foreign thoughts of devotion to the god at the end of time tearing free in agonizing ruptures.
Urella! Don't let go!
The universe rushed to extinction, the vortex wall spinning past in a lethal whirl of nightmares and demons.
Please!
He begged. Urella tugged hard, crying out wordlessly at the terrible exertion. Slowly, with stringy alien goop, clutching at every centimeter of his skin, she pulled him out of the quint body. He came free with an excruciating tear. The extinct universe vanished. Delian juddered wildly. Bright light flared around him. Everything hurt, but nothing like as bad as it had mere instants before. He was waving his limbs around, proper human limbs, though they were wrapped in wires and fibers as if someone had scooped him up in a net. His short hair was on fire as something pulled every last follicle out of his scalp. His flailing stopped as he ran out of strength, and he flopped down onto the bed. There was no air in his lungs, and his chest heaved desperately, trying to get a breath down his throat. The surroundings swam dizzyingly in and out of view. People in medical robes clustered around, worried faces peering down, talking incoherently fast. There was a curving glass wall 3 meters away, with the whole squad pressed up against it, mouths open to shout, eyes wet with tears. Jenk was pounding on the glass. Urit had sunk to his knees. Tiliana was weeping.
What the fuck?
The words were a rasp. He turned his head. Yarella was on the couch next to his, propped up on her shoulders, her scalp invisible beneath a fur of silky white strands finer than any hair. Tears trickled down her cheeks as she stared at him.
Tell, I love you,
he said. Then the memories crashed back with the power of a tsunami, knocking him back down onto the mattress.
The saints are dead,
he told everyone, and burst into tears. London. December 8th, 2206. The time icon flashed up in Ollie's Tarsus lens, the image of an old Seiko wristwatch with hands that clicked around in combination with Ty, his alt-me supplying a tiny tick of clockwork in his audio peripheral. Ancient watches were popular these days. Not that anyone went short of power for an alt-me processor peripheral. They all worked off body heat. But still, it was an understandable fad given London's chronic shortage of electricity and how quirky Solnet was nowadays. Trouble was, Ollie had spent his first 24 years immersed in purely digital displays, so analog messed him up. It took him a second to work out that the way the hands were pointing meant it was 6 o'clock, which was actually 1800 hours, so it was officially evening. In the time before what every Londoner now called Blitz 2, people would have known it was evening, the biggest clue being that the sun used to set every night. But now that clue was no more. Presumably, it still did set. Not that Ollie trusted the government to tell anyone if the Olyix had stopped that from happening as well. When he glanced up at the London Shield, all he saw was the devil's sky, same as it had been for the last 2 years, an eerie violet glare seething kilometers overhead. Sometimes, if he squinted against the intensity, he thought he could make out patterns writhing against the thick barrier of artificially solidified air protecting the city, milk clouds in coffee, but sped up to hypersonic velocity. The atmosphere outside was completely ruined now, decimated by the grotesque amount of energy the Olyix deliverance ships were firing at thousands of city shields across the globe. They'd heated up the air to a point where ocean evaporation had reached a previously unknown peak. Climatologists on the remnant of Solnet were talking about a Venus tipping point, but all Ollie knew was that the air outside had degraded to a constant blast of hot fog. Plants simply couldn't survive the hostile temperatures and humidity. As for animals, they were dying in a catastrophe that surpassed the Pacific Rim firestorms back in 2056. A few months ago, he and Lolo had travelled to the edge of the shield out at Epsom just to see if it really was as bad as everyone said. There in the deserted suburbs, the overhead violet glare condensed into slender ribbons of lightning that crackled around the rim, allowing the foolhardy to glimpse what lay outside. They'd seen the Surrey Hills through the short breaks in the turbulent mantle of smog. Lying beyond the vast dead marsh that now throttled London, silhouettes of the ragged slopes rose to a bleak hellscape of steaming ground, matted with the slushy remnants of vegetation. Any evidence of human habitation, the ancient towns and elegant villages dating back to the time of mythical kings, the new carbon sink forests triumphantly planted throughout the 22nd century, had all been vanquished in the backlash of the invaders' assault. What they'd witnessed left him depressed, yes, but it was the guilt that had inflamed his anger and determination.
The Olyix have killed us, and I helped them. I didn't mean to. I didn't know.
But that made no difference to the shame. He gave the devil's sky a last hateful glance and went back into the small industrial building that was now home, a fancy description for a brick wall shed with a carbon panel roof. They'd found it just off Bellenden Road, squeezed in between the nice houses of Hollygrove and the old railway line. He'd been reluctant to use it at first. The railway arches were too similar to the ones that his old gang, the Southwark Legion, had used. So not only were there painful memory triggers facing him every time he walked outside, there was also the danger of pattern recognition. He was still on Special Branch's most wanted list, so their G8 Turings would have profiled him. What if they'd decided he was emotionally weak, needing to cling to familiarity? They would have him reading those shabby ivy-smothered brick arches as a psychological crutch. Or, "You're so paranoid about the police," as Lolo told him every time he mentioned the possibility. Ollie's rational brain knew C was right. From what he could gain from his cautious and intermittent access to the remnants of Solnet, he was still high up on the authorities' list of wanted suspects. They were never going to forgive and forget the Legion's involvement in the Croydon raid, nor the disaster that was Lichfield Road. Not that the specials would mount surveillance along every stretch of London's disused railway arches, just in case he was so pathetic he needed a familiar landscape for reassurance. Besides, even 2 years into Blitz 2, the government was providing the city's residents with minimal support. Their whole effort was devoted to maintaining the shield and keeping the population fed. Everything else was secondary, or so they said. But Ollie wasn't so sure. The authorities had been very keen to find him. Inside, the building's long main section was basic. Naked brick walls with misted over windows that allowed a weak glimmer of the shield's light to penetrate. A perfect setting for a small-scale industrial enterprise. The last one had been a bespoke ceramic crafts manufacturer that had shut down over a decade ago. But the kilns were still in place, five of them lined up along the middle of the floor, electricity-hungry brutes that fired artistically colourful glazes at temperatures well over 1,000 degrees. Their doors were all shut tight, but Ollie smelled wood smoke in the dank air as he walked past them and muttered a curse. He'd spent more than a month modifying the kilns, covering the internal fire bricks with high-efficiency thermocouples to extract energy from anything burned inside. Any fire was now strictly illegal in London, as in all of Earth's cities that remained under siege from the Olyix. Fire was the one thing that unified every citizen these days, consuming the precious limited oxygen that people needed to breathe. See it, report it, and more often than not give the arsonist a good kicking before the police and firefighters arrived. Ollie could still remember the first time he'd seen a fire engine race past in the street. A magnificent ground vehicle out of history, with lights blazing and siren screaming. He and Lolo had been mesmerized at its appearance, then cheered it on, waving at the crew like a pair of awestruck school kids. Dozens of the big machines had been brought out of museums and renovated since Blitz 2 began. So burning wood in the kilns was a precarious project that had to be well hidden from the neighbours. After fitting the thermocouples, Ollie had stripped the ancient air-conditioning ducts from the rafters and rerouted them. Fans sucked air through the kilns, maintaining a good flow over the logs they burned, before extracting it and sending it down into the old railway storm sewer, where it could dissipate harmlessly among the fatbergs and rats. On a bench at the end of the kilns, a 120-centimeter model of the Night Star starship shone a weird silver from the devil's sky light coming through the windows. Ollie had never even heard of the sci-fi show until a couple of months back, but Hong Kong had released 100 interactive episodes back in 2130, sponsored by a fashion house that had long since vanished. Before Blitz 2, he would have accessed Solnet for every fact about it. But Solnet was a bad idea these days for anything other than basic comms. Too much self-adaptive darkware was loose in the network, left over from the Olyix sabotage. He'd heard about the model from a contact in the Rye Lane market, not long after he'd started asking about collectibles. Adults paying ridiculous money for weird old trash fiction memorabilia was a whole genre he hadn't ever known existed until he discovered Carno Larson, his golden link to Nikolai and vengeance. He didn't even need to steal the model. Nobody paid anything for hobby stuff like that these days, so the owner had been happy to hand it over in exchange for a fully charged domestic quantum cell. Once Ollie got it home, In a trailer behind a bicycle he pedaled all the way back from Pimlico, he'd had to admit it was superb. Nightstar looked like it had been designed by an insect race tripping on heavy-duty narc, and this was a handcrafted one-off, which elevated it to a genuine piece of art. He half expected it to lift off and vanish into hyperspace with a blaze of twisted starlight.
"Time to go," Ollie called.
"I know,"
Lolo replied from the room at the far end. It had been the ceramic company's office, and now served as their bedroom and living room. For Ollie, it was a place to crash and have sex. But for Lolo, it was their home, their honeymoon suite, their fortress castle sheltering them from the horrors of Blitz 2. Which was why Ollie put up with the strips of white, gauzy linen she'd strung up around the bed, and the little candles with mock flames that sprayed out a sweet, musky scent to add to the romance, as well as rugs and pearl and jade trinkets, and the antique black lacquer furniture they'd acquired from a deserted house farther along the street. Lolo came out and smiled broadly. She was dressed as if they were going out to dinner in one of London's restaurants from the time before. Given she was in her female cycle, she'd chosen a purple and white flower pattern dress with a plunging neckline. Her face was expertly dusted with highlighter and rouge, with the devil's sky light shining on high-gloss cherry-red lipstick, her hair in a peacock-blue mohawk. Just looking at how gorgeous she was, Ollie felt himself stiffening.
"You look grand," he said.
"Thank you."
A quick kiss, accompanied by strong perfume, and a smiling Lolo was holding up a basket with a gingham cloth draped across it.
"Let's go."
Ollie gave his flesh mask a quick check in the mirror. As faces went, it was okay. He wasn't happy with the rounded chin, nor the longer nose, and he still wasn't sure about having white skin, but the dimples were nice. And the flesh mask responded well when it came to showing his expressions, although the creams he'd been applying to his own skin did inhibit the subtler emotions. He was strict with himself about keeping the flesh mask on the whole time, avoiding G8 Turing's zeroing in on him with feature recognition. But that freedom came at the price of inflammation and dry skin and some horrific outbreaks of tinea. For Ollie, who had always taken superb care with his appearance in the time before, that was almost unbearable. Fortunately, moisturizer and other basic skin creams could solve the crises, for a prize. He performed a few exaggerated grimaces as a final test.
"Good to go," he announced. "I wish you didn't have to wear that thing all the time. You have a lovely face. I adore looking at you."
"I wish you didn't wear a bra all the time, but hey, those are the breaks."
"Turds, don't you binaries ever think about anything else?"
Laughing, Ollie put his arm around her, and they went outside together, sunglasses on in unison. Ollie's were like ski goggles, hardly the kind of stylish image he wanted, but their thick rims didn't allow the light from the devil's sky around the edges, even with the additional protection afforded by his Tarsus lenses. Too much direct exposure always left him with a migraine. It wasn't far to Reedham Street, where the government nutrition agency had set up a public kitchen in the community centre. Plenty of people were walking toward it. Ollie recognised most of them from the daily visit and nodded occasionally. Saying anything was pointless, thanks to the constant background buzz from the shield straining to hold back the perpetual energy bombardment from the Olyix ships as they attempted to overload the shield generators. Consequently, conversations these days tended to be up close and loud.
"I saw Mark today,"
Lolo said.
"Right,"
Ollie acknowledged as they passed the end of Chadwick Road. One of the big old plane trees halfway along had survived since the siege began, but in the last couple of months it too had succumbed to the absence of rain and the eternal devil's sky. Ollie was mildly sad to see it was finally shedding its yellowed leaves.
"Who's Mark? He's the one who always brings the mushrooms."
"Ah, okay.
Anyway, his friend Sharon has a sister who works at the Defence Ministry. She said one of the seismologist techs told someone in her office that the Olyix aren't tunnelling under the shield anymore. They're playing the long game now. Their ships are heading for the settled star systems, and when they get there, they'll cut the power those planets are feeding back to Earth, and the interstellar portals will die. We won't have any food pellets for the printers, or electricity to run them, so they'll starve us out.
Ollie did his best not to sigh. For someone who had been educated in the supposedly excellent egalitarian school system of Delta Pavonis, Lolo could be fucking stupid at times.
That's a load of bollocks. You've got to stop living off gossip. What you just said is a paradox. I'm sure the Olyix are heading for the settled worlds, but if they cut the power that's coming to us from Delta Pavonis and New Washington and all the others, Earth's city shields will fail. His finger pointed up at the devil sky. And that mother monster will come crashing down, just like it did last month in Berlin. We'll all die, which is exactly what they can't have horned. Not after the effort they've put into beating us down. Berlin's shield fail didn't kill everyone, Lolo pouted. Just the ones the storm hit when it burst down. She paused for a second. And the ones who drowned when the river spray flooded back in. Thankfully for everyone else, the Olyix flew in real fast and converted them into cocoons, so they got to live on. Sort of, Ollie scoffed. Lucky them. They get to see what the universe is like at the end of time. You can be such a downer.
Most like, when the power does get cut from the settled worlds, the Olyix will just starve us out. We'll walk meekly into the arkship 2 million by 2 million.
We wouldn't. People are better than that. Face it. If there's a choice between dying in a tsunami of ruined supercharged toxic atmosphere,
or taking a chance as a mutated freak cocoon that's on a trillion-year pilgrimage to meet an alien god, what do you do?
Well, I'm not going to give in. I'm going to make a stand.
That statement was a wide opening into a world of snark that Ollie wasn't prepared to enter. Not tonight.
And I'll be standing right there beside you.
Lolo gave him a happy hug. The Bellenden Community Centre was a civic hall built 80 years ago on the site of an old school. Its composite panels had been printed to resemble traditional London brick, though that had faded over the decades, so they now looked like walls made of a kid's fraying building blocks. There was a constant stream of people walking through the entrance arch, most of them carrying bags full of cold dishes they'd printed out at home to accompany their hot meal. Nearly half of them were refugees who'd poured into the city when the Olyix started their invasion. Everybody who lived in the countryside, or the ribbon towns, had come, seeking safety under the shields, boosting the population toward 11 million. They were crammed into old deserted buildings with few amenities. Communal was how most people lived these days. Ollie didn't mind. It allowed for plenty of anonymity. The scent of cooking filled the air as they went up the community center steps. Inside, the main hall had been laid out like a makeshift cafe that no one had quite got around to regularizing, with a jumble of various tables and chairs taking up most of the floor, and long stainless steel canteen counters along one side. Rations were served from a hatchway that had two light-armored police standing on either side. You could either choose to have the rations cooked in the center or take them home. Most people ate in the hall, as electricity was scarce in this part of town. Who had enough kilowatts to heat food every day? Ollie queued up and held out his R token for the woman inside the hatch. Registering for it had been surprisingly easy. Just after the siege started, he'd stolen Davis Mohan's identity, one of his old neighbors from Copeland Road. When he and Lolo had begun exploring the nearby houses, they'd found Davis lying on his kitchen floor in an advanced stage of cocooning, his body a battle of modified organs, limbs almost gone, fading in and out of consciousness. For Ollie, a fake identity was a simple enough task, one he'd done dozens of times before while he was in the Southwark Legion. If anything, this was even easier. When rationing was introduced in those chaotic early days, Solnet was reduced to a Dark Ages version of itself, and the checks were childish. The woman behind the hatchway scanned his R token and handed him a ribbon of pellet bags and a packet of assorted texture powders. Lolo stepped up.
Any salmon powder? Sorry, sweetie, not today. Got some blueberry powder, if you want. It's quite good if you mix it with water and let it set in a mould.
An ice cube tray is best.
That's so lovely of you. Thank you.
Lolo pulled a small jar out from under the basket's gingham cloth.
Almond-flavoured marshmallows. I've been experimenting. Let me know what you think.
They exchanged a smile. Ollie thought the ribbon of pellet bag she gave Lolo was a lot longer than the one he'd got. He shook his head in bemusement.
Is there anyone in here you don't flirt with?
I'm not flirting,
she exclaimed in an indignant tone.
I'm just nice and talk to people. It wouldn't hurt you to try it sometime. We're all in this together, you know.
I talk to people, the ones I need to.
Oh, storm a brewing. You're so hot when you do that moody Mr. Serious voice.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
Mind your mouth, boyfriend. There are children in here.
They went and stood in line at the counter. At the first station, they handed over a couple of the pellet bags each. Ollie looked at the labels on the powders he'd been given and dropped the one for butter chicken on the counter.
You'll smell of that all night,
Lolo complained.
Stop whinging. It won't smell or taste anything like butter chicken.
A couple of minutes later, they'd made it down to the serving station. Lolo took a pair of plates out of the basket. Ollie watched with an impassive face as the bloke behind the counter ladled a pile of gingery slop onto his plate.
It doesn't matter. This is just what you have to do so you can rescue Bic and Gren, he told himself.
They sat down at one of the tables. Lolo made a show of taking the additional dishes she'd prepared out of the basket, all peppy and cheerful as each one was announced.
I made some salad, look, and some naan bread, though to be honest, it's more like a pizza base,
and some chocolate mousse for pudding.
She produced a bottle with what Ollie really hoped was apple juice, because it looked too yellow for his liking. Besides, alcoholic drinks were banned from the community centre.
Thanks, he said. It's not easy, you know. I could do with some more electricity. Can't spare any. Sorry.
Lolo gave a martyred sigh.
Right. Look, I'm close, okay? Tonight should give me Larson. I don't want you to get hurt.
I caused the hurt, remember?
Ollie, please.
Don't worry, I'm careful. You know it.
Ollie picked up one of the leaves from the salad dish. That was a mistake. It was basically a thin green biscuit that tasted like what he imagined raw seaweed would when it grew next to a sewer outlet. The tables around them started to fill up, and with it the volume of conversation rose. Kids started to run around, and older people were helped to tables by younger relatives. Several civic health agency nurses worked their way along the hall, checking up on their patients, asking families if the youngsters were okay. One couple was carrying a newborn, which Ollie frowned at.
How could they do that? How could they have a kid in this place?
Jed and Lily D, they're sweet people, and their baby's a real cutie. I've cuddled him a few times.
Why?
I mean, don't they understand what's happening? Our two chances of getting out of Blitz 2 are none and fuck all. How could they bring a kid into this world?
Because we can't afford to give up hope. Just look at him. He's so adorable. We need babies to remind us why we're alive.
That's not hope. That's being stupid and selfish.
Shaking his head, he bit into another salad leaf and tried not to pull a face.
Evening, guys. How's it going?
Ollie looked up to find Horatio Seymour standing at the end of the table. The senior manager helped run a half dozen district food operations in this part of London. He'd been some kind of hotshot with the Benjamin charity in the time before. Ollie had even encountered him a few times when social agency outreach workers had tried to get Bic and his parkour equipe to come along to a youth gym. Then one other time, an unnerving, not quite encounter along the Thames, just after the last of Ollie's Legion friends had been killed, which made Horatio someone who actually knew Ollie's real face. Every time he turned up at the Bellenden Community Centre, with his neutral smile and non-judgmental attitude, Ollie's nerves kicked in. He knew that was stupid. The flesh mask was flawless. But still.
We're good, thanks, Lolo said. Would you like some lemon squash?
It's lemon,
Ollie blurted.
Ignore my friend. He's such a philistine.
Horatio's smile became more genuine.
No, thanks. So you're all right. Got something to do in the day?
We trade,
Lolo said. We do all right. Nothing too illegal, I hope.
Absolutely not. I'm into food textures.
If you got some what's left in a quantum battery, that's my payment. I can work you up most flavours. Vegetables are a speciality. No offence to the people in here, of course.
Of course, Horatio said. Glad to hear it. But if you do ever need help, you can always call on me. I'm not official, not part of the council or police.
Okay? That's very kind, Lolo said. We need more people like you.
Horatio nodded affably and moved on to the next table. Ollie spooned up some more of the not butter chicken goop.
I don't like him.
He's a good man, Lolo protested. You're just horribly biased against authority.
Not everyone in government is automatically a corrupt fascist, you know. And anyway, you heard him. He's not actually officialdom.
Then what's he doing here?
Helping people,
Lolo gestured around exuberantly.
Without people like him, people who care about others, where would we be? Breaking through the barriers the bastard Zangaris have built across the interstellar portals and getting off-world to where we'd be safe. Nowhere in the galaxy is safe from the Olyix.
The Exodus habitats will be. Not that we'll ever make it there.
We will,
Lolo insisted. Once you find Larson, we'll have ourselves some real trading power.
Oh, so now you want me to go after him? Don't be such a trash king.
I love you, Ollie. I've literally given you my life because I believe in you.
Which wasn't a responsibility Ollie had wanted at all. But he had to admit, for all her stupid opinions and neurotic nerves and fragile mien, Lolo made this purgatory just about bearable.
I'll find him. Don't worry. I'm real close now.
A couple of hours after the evening meal, Ollie pedalled up the north end of Rye Lane. The east side was taken up with a big old shopping centre that had been derelict for 30 years. Behind its boarded-up facade, it had been decaying sluggishly, attracting layers of graffiti and moss, while developers negotiated with the local council and the mayor's office about turning the big site into luxury apartments. Since the siege started and Solnet commerce failed, traders had found their own use for it. Stalls had set up in the old shops, some no more than an over-optimistic kid sitting on a chair hawking a box of scavenged junk, while the more realistic merchants had metal-meshed kiosks and some tough fellas on either side to protect the commodities. By now, Ollie had good relationships with several of them. He wheeled the bike up to Rebecca the Owl, who was in her usual gothic black lace dress with druid purple dreadlocks hanging down to her waist.
"Davis," she drawled, "looking good.
Not so trash yourself. You bring me some wholesome kinds?"
"Very wholesome." Ollie took 3 quantum batteries out of the bike's panniers. Rebecca the L's narc drifter smile lifted as she took them from him and slipped the first into a charge port on the kiosk. She let out a soft whistle of appreciation as she quickly read how many kilowatts he'd brought.
"Impressive. Have you got a cable direct to Delta Pavonis?"
"Something like that."
"So are we in business?"
"Davis, I appreciate quality and you never fail me."
"You have them?"
She gestured to one of her tough fellas. He produced a small aluminum case from inside the kiosk and gave Ollie a disapproving look.
"Go ahead,"
Rebecca the L said, as her dreamy composure returned. Ollie slipped the catches and opened the lid a crack. Inside, 2 synth slugs, the size of his little finger, rested in protective foam, their dark skin glistening as if dusted with a sprinkling of tiny stars. Designed in some black lab, using 8-letter DNA to craft unnatural components into their basic body, they had a bioprocessor cluster instead of a natural slug's nerve cells. He told Ty, his alt-me, to ping them. Data splashed into his Tarsus lens, confirming their functionality.
"Be seeing you," he told her.
"You don't look dangerous, Davis. You have a pleasant face, guile-free. But it's your eyes that give you away. When I look into them, I see only a depth that comes from darkness."
Right. Catch you later."
Ollie could feel Rebecca watching him as he wheeled his bike away. It took plenty of self-control not to look back. The next kiosk belonged to Angus T., who claimed he traded whatever you wanted, but didn't have the kind of connections Rebecca the L had. Ollie offered him a couple of quantum batteries he charged up from the kilns.
"I don't know where you keep getting electricity from," Angus said, "but this makes you my most valuable supplier.
Happy to help. Now, what are you offering?"
After a relatively good-natured haggle, he wound up with 9 tubs of food pellets and a jumble of texture powders, plus a bag full of empty quantum batteries.
"I get fast refusal when they're full," Angus said as he passed them over.
"You know I give the best deals around."
"Sure thing."
Ollie held his hand out.
"So?"
Angus handed over the main event, a packet of zero narc pads.
"More like it."
Ollie hadn't used narc since the siege began, but Lolo hadn't stopped. C had made an effort to cut down, but her dependency was starting to worry Ollie.
"Hey, can you throw in some duct tape too?"
Angus gave him a calculating look, then produced a half roll from under the counter.
"You want anything else? My shoes? My girlfriend to bang?"
Laughing, Ollie grabbed the roll.
"Tape's fine. Be seeing you."
"Sure.
What you want that for anyway? Thought maybe I'd see if I'm into bondage."
"You take that shit easy, kid. People can get hurt."
"Thanks."
Ollie turned away from the kiosk.
"Voice of experience."
He could guess the hand gesture Angus was making behind his back. It took Ollie nearly an hour to cycle from Rye Lane up to Dulwich. These days, the clear path was anything but. 2 years on, and still nobody had moved the broken taxis and cabbies and baggies that cluttered the concrete, and now it was getting worse, as people started tipping their rubbish wherever they felt like. And of course, most of his route seemed to be uphill, leaving him sweating heavily, which was going to play hell on his face again. He'd never even thought about Connections London Metro Hub Network in any of the time before. It just was. Now distance had become achingly real again, a handicap of effort, sweat, and time. As he pedalled away with straining legs, all he could think about was stepping onto his old boardies and rolling along effortlessly one last time. It wasn't like he didn't have the electricity to power it up again, but that kind of profligacy would draw way too much attention. He reached the end of Lordship Lane and turned west onto the A205. The road cut through sports pitches that were now just desert dry soil as hard as stone, enclosed by prickly dead hedges. But the goalposts were still standing, their scabbed white paint gleaming oddly under the radiant devil sky. Past the playing fields, the hedges changed to high brick walls, guarding big houses. Ollie stopped pedaling and freewheeled along slowly, until he came to a nouveau riche, 3-story cylindrical house, complete with mock Tudor facade, that belonged to one Brandon Shumder. The gates at the end of a short gravel drive were tall, topped with spikes that weren't entirely ornamental. He didn't expect them to be a problem. In fact, he felt a rush of satisfaction that he'd finally arrived here. Without Solnit, it had taken 2 years of dealing in markets, building contacts, paying in kilowatt hours or narc, and trading his own information, all with one goal: finding Nikolai. Ollie still didn't have her, but he knew for certain now that Nikolai and Jade worked for the Paynor family, one of the major crime families operating out of North London. That just left him with trying to find a way to reach the Paynors. They were a tight bunch, and even tighter nowadays. But that was what he was good at: planning. It was like his superpower, one of the main reasons the Southwark Legion had never been caught. He just needed an angle no one would expect. More quiet questions, and he had heard the name Carno Larson, who, among other things, had acted as the Paynor family's money man in the time before, laundering illegal Watt dollars clean and loading them into the legitimate banking system. There was plenty of cheap talk about Carno, but solid details, like his location, were hard to find. A couple of small-timers suggested Brandon Shumder might know. Ollie stared at the gates from the other side of the clear path and raised his arm, running a scan. He'd salvaged several systems from the old stealth suit he used to wear on raids with the Legion. There was no point putting it on now. Not even its hazy grey fabric could conceal him under the insistent light of the devil's sky. So, in a marathon whinge session, Lolo had hand-stitched some of its systems into his leather biker's jacket, along with a layer of armor fabric. Ty splashed the results, showing zero power in the gates, and specifically the lock. So not even Brandon Shumda had the wealth for that kind of wattage these days. Ollie's Tarsus lens zoomed in, revealing a slim chain holding the two gates together, with a padlock dangling down, its shiny brass casing almost a shout for attention.
"Too easy,"
he muttered suspiciously. But no, a scan of the house's curving wall revealed no active electrical circuits. A sign of the times. Before Blitz II, only the seriously wealthy could have afforded this house, but material things weren't a measure of wealth anymore. Therefore, personal security wasn't currently high on anyone's priority list. Ollie fingered his insurance collar, a black band with a lace trim that fitted so perfectly around his neck that it could have been a tattoo. A silly, nervous gesture. Its icon was a solid, unchanging splash in his Tarsus lens. But given who he was going up against, checking wasn't paranoia. If Nikolai was as good as everyone said, she might have heard he was asking questions. He went over to the gates and pressed a small ball of thermon onto the padlock's hoop. There was an amber flare, and the metal melted away. The sensor splash showed him there was no one on the road or lurking behind the desiccated bushes. Technically, it was nighttime. Hard to judge, but with the sun below the horizon, the purple gleam from above was maybe slightly dimmer. He could see a couple of lights on the house, shining out of second-floor windows. He shut the gate behind him and walked up to the front door. Not a long walk, but the sensation it gave him let loose a whole slew of bittersweet memories. He'd always had the Legion to back him up when they went on raids or burglaries. Now it was their phantom faces that accompanied him down the drive. Ty splashed data about the house's network. Signal strength was low, but it provided connectivity with the remnants of Solnit. Ollie launched a darkware package into the node. The front door was another faux Tudor monstrosity, all bulky panels with iron bolts driven through them. He took a strip of charge tape out of the cycle's pannier, ready to apply it to the lock, when Ty reported the darkware had gained full control over the house network. Ollie drew his nerve-block pistol and ordered the front door to unlock. A soft click confirmed it had obeyed, and he kicked it open. Bursting in like some goon out of a Sumiko Interactive pumped up his exhilaration. Nothing like the buzz he used to get on Legion raids, but still his confidence and focus were high. The wood-paneled hall was dark and long, ending in a broad, curving staircase.
"Hey, motherfucker!" he bellowed. "Come out, now! I want to talk to you!"
Ty told him someone's alt-me was connecting to a house network node upstairs, requesting an emergency link to the police G8 Turing. "Response insertion," he ordered his alt-me. The icons changed, confirming he was the only response Shumda was going to get.
"Dick move, Brandon Shumda," he said. "Even if you'd got through to the cops, my dark ops team inside your house right now could slaughter any tactical squad before they reach the front door. Now get your ass downstairs like a good boy, or there will be consequences."
The phantom faces escorting him smiled their approval as he imagined Shumda's reaction to his panicked call for help.
"Don't shoot,"
a voice called from upstairs. "Please, we're not armed." Brandon Shumda shuffled into view at the top of the stairs. He was taller than Lolo, and so thin Ollie thought he might be ill. But then Mensi, his wife, was standing behind him, and she was almost as tall and equally thin. Ollie never could get over the way rich people lived. Cosmetics and anti-aging procedures, sure. Who wouldn't if you had the money? But shit like this was just creepy.
"Get down here," he ordered.
"Yes, yes,"
Shumda said anxiously. He put a foot on the first step as if he expected it to electrocute him.
"Take anything you want. Anything. We'll open the safe for you."
"Keep coming."
Shumda was four steps from the bottom when Ollie shot Mensi with the nerve block pistol. She juddered helplessly, a forced gagging sound coming from her throat, and started to collapse.
No! Shamda cried, and struggled to catch her. He made it to the hall floor, the two of them going down in a tangle as Mensi's weight drove him to his knees. Ollie shot him, too. 5 minutes later, he'd used the duct tape to secure Mensi to a heavy dining room chair, while Brandon was taped spread-eagled on the table. Ollie had run out of duct tape before the last leg was secured, so he had to cut off a curtain cord and use that. He waited until the nerve block had faded and they'd started to recover. Mensi began a miserable wailing until he went and stood in front of her, pressing the pistol to her temple.
This is a nerve blocker. It's meant to incapacitate your body if I shoot you from a distance, he explained. If I fire it now, at zero range, it might just as well be dropping your brain into a food blender. It will turn you into a zombie, and not the good kind. So be quiet. Understand?
She gave him a petrified look, the tears streaming down her face, but she clenched her jaw tightly shut. Ollie went back to the table and looked down at Brandon.
You don't have to do this, Brandon said. I told you to take anything you want. Just please don't hurt us.
Okay, Ollie said. You sound like a reasonable man. We both want to get this over as quickly as possible, with minimal pain, so this should be easy. You know, if my friend Lars was here, he'd enjoy beating 7 types of crap out of you.
Brandon tensed up, a whimper escaping from his lips. But Lars is dead. I'm sorry.
Why? Ollie taunted. You didn't know him. Or did you?
I don't think so. No.
No. But I'm trying to find the person I hold responsible, so you'll understand why I'm anxious to get the right information.
Yes.
You're in banking, right? To be exact, the Rheindahl Commerzbank.
Yes.
Good. Then I've got the right person. Ollie leaned over, putting his face centimetres from Brandon's.
Where does Carno Larsen live? Who?
Oh, shit.
Wrong answer. But I don't know.
Ollie stuffed a napkin into Brandon's mouth, forcing a lot of the linen down. Brandon strained against it, making muffled gasps.
Remember,
Ollie told Mensi, one word from you and... He made a pistol with 2 fingers and shot her with it. She whimpered in terror. This was the part Ollie had kept telling himself, promising himself he could do. Right from the start, he'd known that Brandon would be difficult. This was the kind of man who would have been given security counter-training by the bank, and there'd be fear, too. Fear of giving up Carno, and what would happen to him if he did. Making him talk needed a whole new approach and attitude. Ollie had never done that before. The Legion had concentrated on scams and raids. No one had got hurt. Well, apart from the ones Lars had beaten to a pulp, but even Lars didn't do this kind of thing. Trond could have done it without hesitation, him with that unnervingly cold streak, and maybe Piotr too. But they were dead, so it was all down to Ollie. He put the case he'd got from Rebecca the L on the table next to Brandon and opened the lid. Brandon stopped moaning and tried to get a look at what was inside. Ollie slipped on the protective gloves and picked up the first synth slug. Its strange grainy coating sparkled in the weak light filtering through the windows.
Do you know what this is?
Ollie asked. Brandon shook his head, his muted voice trying to protest.
It's a synth slug.
Ollie held it up as if seeing it for the first time.
And that sparkle is the artificial diamond bristles it grows, the same as we grow hair. You know what they say about diamonds, apart from being a girl's best friend? The hardest natural substance there is. Cuts through anything, really. Cuts.
Brandon froze, his chest heaving as he tried to yell in protest.
The slug doesn't have a brain, Ollie said, but it does have a bioprocessor cluster which allows me to control it.
He pressed it against the sole of Brandon's foot. This was it, the point where he'd either chicken out or... He closed his eyes. Instead of Ty's splash in his tarsus lens, all he could see were 2 cocoons, his brother Bic and Gran. For a long moment, he stood perfectly still. Then he activated the synth slug's control icon.
It started to wriggle against Brandon's foot. The tiny diamond fibers gnawed through the skin, and blood began to seep out. Brandon was desperately trying to scream, the cords on his neck standing proud as he struggled against the tape holding him down. Ollie took out the second synth slug and pressed it to Brandon's other foot. It squirmed about, chewing its way into the flesh.
The best thing about them is they can grind their way up through you very precisely,
Ollie explained to a frantic, tormented Brandon. To start with, I'll get them to stay inside the bone, munching their way up the marrow. After all, I don't want them to cut an artery or something critical. That way you'd bleed out and die before you told me what I want to know. And I really want to know where Carno Larson lives.
But you're a big, strong, determined bloke, ain't ya? Not some pussy who'll squeal and give it up. So it's going to take a while. After they've chewed all the leg marrow into soup, I'll steer them into your ribcage. Don't worry, I'll keep them out of your spine. Gotta leave all those nerves intact so you can feel what's happening, yeah?
On the table, Brandon looked like he was having a heart attack, writhing around so badly the tape was cutting into his wrists. Ollie ordered the slugs to pause. They were barely a centimetre inside Brandon's feet, with blood and pulverized bone running out of the holes they'd gouged. He leaned over, staring down at his captive.
Did you want to say something?
Brandon was shouting so hard he even managed to dislodge the napkin slightly. Ollie put his finger to his lips.
Before I take the napkin out, I'm going to repeat the question. Where does Carno Larson live? If you say anything other than that, if you start swearing or threatening me, I won't let you speak again until the slugs have reached your hip bones via your balls. Understand?
A near hysterical Brandon nodded feverishly. So slowly it was a taunt. Ollie pulled the napkin out of Brandon's mouth.
Docklands! Brandon yelled. Carno's in Docklands! Royal Victoria Docks, the Icona apartment block, third floor, I promise! He never leaves anymore, not since Blitz 2 started. He'll be there. Cheers, fella,
Ollie said, and stuffed the napkin back in. He retrieved the synth slugs and dropped them back in the case. He grinned cheerfully at a weeping Mensie and walked out through the front door. He managed to take 5 steps along the drive before he doubled over and threw up onto the gravel. Delta Pavonis. December 9th, 2206. 8 AUs beyond the star's outer cometary belt, the rim of the circular portal glowed a rich cobalt blue as it expanded out to 50 meters in diameter. An Olyix mid-level transport ship flew out of the opening, a truncated cone, 60 meters long and 30 wide, its fuselage a dark burgundy color that absorbed what little light there was. Thin, purple ion plumes gusted out of gill-like vents near the rear, and it began to accelerate at a steady 1.3 Gs.
Gravitonic drive at 70%,
Jessica May announced cheerfully. Sitting opposite her, in the pearl-grey virtual chamber that was the Avenging Heretics Bridge, Callum saw her lips twitch in amusement. He wondered just how much of that was real. The nerve capture routine could be adjusted for reaction sensitivity, either toning down or emphasizing every expression and tick his emotional state produced. Like Alec and Yuri, Callum couldn't be arsed with it. Faffing about with crap like that was just a higher resolution version of choosing an Express Me icon for Solnit comms. He'd stopped doing that when he was 15. Same with the bridge, which was as basic as you could get. 5 consoles with wraparound screens, and flight controls so simple they could have come from the late 20th century. They didn't exist, of course. This virtual was being fed into his brain via a cortical interface. Sochko had designed it for them, warning it was dangerous. If the Olyix ever gained access to the Avenging Heretics network, the One Mind could subvert their minds with a neurovirus.
So we'd better not get caught, Alec had replied levelly at the planning meeting. That had been 18 months ago.
Callum watched the data on his console screen, the colorful wave motions of graphs and icons similar to a Tarsus lens splash. When he focused on them, The rest of the bridge drifted away, leaving him at the center of pure information. Space this far out from Delta Pavonis was relatively clear, confirmed by the minimal impacts against the protective distortion field around the ship. Mass sensors confirmed there was nothing other than hydrogen atoms and a few grains of carbon within 1,000 kilometers of the hull. Power flow from the fusion generators into the systems seemed to be okay, and the network was glitch-free. "Who's first?" Jessica asked. The information fell back into the console screen, and Callum was looking around at the other four chairs. They were laid out in a simple pentagon, with Kandara on his right, then Jessica, Alec, and Yuri. All of them had spent the last year training for the flight, trying to get their heads around the gravitonic drive and wormhole theory. Their collective age didn't help. New concepts didn't sit well in old brain cells. But slowly they'd come to control the simulations without screwing up too badly.
"I'll go," Callum said.
Alec laughed.
"You owe me 50, he told Yuri.
Yuri looked glum.
"What?"
Callum asked.
"Mr. Save the World twice before lunch," Alec gloated. "Of course you'd want to fly this fucker. Feel the glory again."
"Hey, I was in emergency detox for 8 years, a century ago. I gave up my adrenaline junkie days when I left. I want to get this right because we have to. And I didn't hear you two pussies racing to volunteer."
Kandara rolled her eyes.
"Boys, boys."
Callum didn't think her nerve capture routine was turned up either.
"Take it, Callum," Jessica said.
She and Kandara exchanged a smirk. The control columns on Callum's console went active. He placed his hands on them. It was a strange feeling. He wasn't holding the ergonomic handles, which was the vision being fed into his mind. Instead, his nerves sensed patterns like slow-moving currents of water. The screen's information closed in on him again, and he shifted the patterns, perceiving the gravitonic drive's energies reformatting. The Avenging Heretic's vector altered. Navigational data expanded, and he started plotting a new course, shifting a shoal of cursors by thought alone.
"Is my visual focus doing that?"
Reassigning his perception and responses to integrate with the ship's network was still a work in progress. Jessica had said that eventually they wouldn't even need the bridge simulacrum. Control would be an automatic thought. Callum considered she might have been a bit generous in her assessment of how adaptive they were. The variable portal they'd come through was now 3,000 kilometers behind them. 18,000 kilometers away, a dark rubble pile asteroid was tumbling along its lonely orbit. Acceleration vectors materialized in the navigation data, and Callum began to shape the drive patterns to match them, putting the ship on a course that would end in a rendezvous.
"Nicely done," Yuri said.
The Avenging Heretic accelerated up to 2.2 Gs. There were some fluctuations in the thrust, which Callum did his best to get under control. His manipulation of the patterns wasn't as proficient as he'd like.
"Don't overcompensate,"
Jessica said. "Keep the alterations smaller and smoother. The routines are adaptive. They'll learn your style." Callum did his best to squash an instinctive defensiveness. She was advising, not criticizing. The oscillations in the drive leveled out. They took it in turns to fly the Avenging Heretic, Yuri decelerating for rendezvous, Kandara maneuvering around the frozen asteroid, Alec taking them back to the portal. Callum felt Alec had a long way to go before he was as proficient as the others, but didn't say anything. Jessica brought them back through the portal and onto the cradle in Crew's station. Atmosphere began to vent back into the big chamber. Callum looked around the bridge, and suddenly the effort of de-tanking was depressing.
"We could just stay here until the next test flight."
"No way," Kandara said. "We're going to be spending a long time in these tanks, and I, for one, am not adding to that."
Her image imploded in a silent cloud of pixels.
"The design crew needs to run analysis on the tanks," Jessica said.
"This is the first time they've been used on an actual flight. Simulation runs can only tell us so much." She shrugged and vanished. Yuri's grin was so wide, he had to have his nerve capture routine turned up to 11.
"Disengage the suspension tank," Callum told Apollo, his alt-me.
The neural interface routines were now good enough to read his vocalization impulses directly. Besides, he couldn't use his voice peripheral, not with an oxygen nozzle filling his mouth. Feeling seeped back into his brain, along with the thick, gurgling sound of fluid draining out of the suspension tank. The frame holding him juddered slightly, and then there was a solid floor under his feet. A long strip of green and amber medical icons splashed across his tarsus lens, and he blinked his eyes open. Directly ahead of him was the curving glass wall of the tank, smeared in clear fluid. With full body sensation returned, he could feel the droplets all over his skin, and sneezed them out of his nose. The tube in his mouth wriggled outward, creating a moment of panic. Serpent down my throat. He started to gag as the end pulled free of his lips, dripping goo around his feet. More icons flashed and turned green. Umbilicals disconnected from his navel sockets with popping sounds. The metallic tubes coiled away into the top of the tank. Then he was trying not to grimace as the waste pipes withdrew. Final icon warning, and he braced his feet. The frame released him, and the glass wall parted to let him out. He was standing on a metal grid in the Avenging Heretic's central chamber, a cylinder 20 meters high, divided into three sections by the grid floors. The ship had been heavily modified from its Olyix design and refitted with five suspension chambers. Human equipment and materials had supplanted the original walls, producing a metallic tube cluttered with blank system cabinets that made Callum think of a 20th century submarine. The emphasis was on function rather than the elan of 23rd century design, while the disturbingly coffin-like tanks seemed to have been resurrected from the period of history occupied by the Inquisition.
"You were in a hurry to get out of there," Callum said to Kandara as they waited for Alec and Yuri to climb down the ladder to the lower deck.
"And you're okay in that white bubble?"
she asked curiously.
"Sure, I'm not. We need to refine it. A lot. It does its job.
Callum, we're going to be spending years together in the bridge simulacrum. I need to not get spooked every time."
"We can add some texture. Like you say, we'll have plenty of time to try out new designs."
"And the smell?"
"What smell?"
"Exactly, there isn't one. Or hadn't you noticed?"
No, he admitted.
"Well, that's one nerve impulse the interface hasn't mastered."
She glanced down the ladder as Jessica followed Alec below.
"I wonder if the Niana forgot to build a sense of smell into their metahuman bodies."
"I doubt it. I remember Jessica being quite the wine connoisseur when we were working on security after the cancer operation."
Kandara's eyebrows rose gleefully.
"You two dated?"
"No, strictly work social events. Two teams getting properly acquainted."
"Okay.
Hey."
But she was gone, sliding down the ladder with a grace he could never match. The lower deck housed the gym, the G8 Turing medical bay, and the common washroom. Standing in the shower, Callum checked the umbilical sockets clustered around his navel, where the skin was still red and tender. He'd have to mention that to the medical team. The implants should have healed fully by now. Like the others, he'd spent the last 10 months in and out of the station's clinic, having extensive body modifications to prepare him for the mission. His stomach was new, a biologic organ grown in an Iana-style initiator, allowing him to digest a direct nutrient feed from the suspension tank systems. Then his bones had all been reinforced with high-density fibers at the same time as his internal membranes had undergone gene therapy to strengthen them, all with the goal of making him more resilient to high acceleration forces. After an organ audit, the doctors had gone on to announce they were going to grow him new kidneys, a prostate, and a left eye, and would replace a meter of lower intestine. "Just to be safe, you're going to undergo some unique physiological stresses a long way from any medical help." Hearing that news was as depressing as the memory of all the time he'd spent convalescing after the first tranche of procedures. He'd always kept himself in good shape, but he did get some malicious satisfaction from knowing that Yuri had even more replacements scheduled, starting with his liver, which was only 20 years old anyway. The doctors kept on telling him to stop drinking, which Yuri kept on ignoring. And then there was poor old Alec, who'd had to give up his peripherals.
"They won't do well in the tank," Jessica told him sternly.
So he sulked off to DC for a week to some classified government clinic to have his even more classified spy gizmos extracted. Kandara, to no one's surprise, needed the least remedial work. However, like Alec, she had to have a small armory's worth of weapon peripherals removed.
"It's like being naked on my high school prom dance floor," she confessed at dinner after the technicians had finished taking them out.
Callum had nearly made a smart-ass comment, but decided cowardice was the best option. Besides, Jessica had later confided that Kandara had some initiator-made peripherals put back in and told him not to tell Alec. Lankin came in as they were all getting dressed. The Connection science director had been appointed as the Avenging Heretics mission controller, marrying the technological requirements with the mission objective. Callum was glad someone with that level of experience and ability was overseeing the flight. Although he was only in his 50s, Lankin was damn good at his job.
"You're all needed at a full council meeting," Lankin told them.
"When?" Alec asked.
"As soon as you're dressed."
Callum exchanged a glance with Yuri. That Lankin had come in person to tell them was significant.
"Was something going critical before we left?"
Kandara asked.
"If it was, I didn't know," Alec said gruffly.
There was no formal title, nothing in any legitimate record. They were just known as the Council. Officially, they advised the Sol Senate Security Office, who implemented any policy or action. In reality, they'd been tasked with formulating the plan to strike back against the Olyix, no matter what the cost and how long it took. The cruise station conference room was windowless, as if to emphasize its ultra-secure location somewhere in the Delta Pavonis system. A large table, carved from dark red rock, took up the center, with a vase of white and orange chrysanthemums sitting on its polished surface. Callum smelled the flowers as soon as he came in, and glanced over at Kandara, who was laughing at something Alec said. Now that she'd mentioned the lack of a smell in the interface simulation, he knew he was doomed to notice it constantly. Ainsley Zangari III was already sitting on one of the leather chairs, along with his sister, Danuta. It had been a while since Ainsley Zangari himself had attended a meeting of the council. Cruise station rumor had it that the founder of Connection was undergoing a lot of therapy to help him cope with the fact that his decades-old paranoia about the Olyix had finally become real.
"How's your grandfather?"
Alec asked politely.
"He's managing, thank you,"
Ainsley III said. Callum nodded sagely.
"Managing? No mention of recovering."
He sat down at the table, greeting his aide, Eldland, who was sitting next to Loy in the corner of the room.
"How did it go?" Eldland asked keenly.
"I got to fly it," Callum said modestly.
"Wow! I'm not the greatest pilot, but the G8 Turing handles the flight specifics. It's more like giving directions."
"And the cortical interface?"
"Good, but interpretation could be better. We just need time to get used to the system."
Eldland and Loy exchanged a glance.
"What?"
Callum asked.
"Time has never been our ally," Loy said.
Callum was going to ask his aide what he'd heard when Amelia Urich and Adjutant General Johnston came in together. They sat down without ceremony. Last to arrive was Sochko, accompanied by Captain Tral, who as always was wearing her grey uniform.
"Let's get started," Amelia said.
"Sochko?
There is a squadron of dangerous ships flying down the wormhole to the Sol system,"
the human Nayana said.
"I sensed it in the Salvation of Life One Mind 3 hours ago, as soon as a transport ship arrived from the Enclave with the information. The One Mind seems very confident."
"You mean these new ships are going to be more dangerous than the Deliverance ships?" Alec said.
"Are they the resolution ships you're always warning us about?"
"No, these are not resolution ships."
"So what sort of ships are we talking about?"
Ainsley III asked.
"A new type. I don't have a classification for them, as the Nayana have not been aware of them before, but I did see their purpose in the One Mind's thoughts. They're carrying some kind of gravitonic generator. I'm not sure how it works, but presumably it's a variant on the gravitonic drive. However, the intent was very clear in the One Mind's thoughts. The enclave had provided them specifically to wreck the city generators.
How can a gravity drive wreck the generators?
Danuta asked.
If they can focus the gravity, make a coherent beam of it, which is what I think they're doing, they'll pull the shield generator away from the ground, literally rip it free and suck it up into the air.
Hellfire, how sure are you? Amelia asked.
Sotchko gave her a regretful shrug. I can't give you percentages.
Reading the One Mind's thought streams is like standing in a waterfall and trying to make out individual droplets. If I put my hand out to catch one, it disturbs the flow, and they'll know I'm there. But there are some droplets, the important ones, the ones it keeps focusing on, that repeat constantly. It has been reviewing the information and capabilities ever since the transport ship arrived. I think the Olyix must have made them specifically to end the siege.
How long until they arrive?
Johnston asked.
10 days.
Fuck, Callum grunted. What the hell do we do now? Ainsley the Third demanded.
Bring Estay forward, Johnston said. Nothing else we can do.
Amelia gave him a startled look.
Are we ready for strike back?
No. It's scheduled for 6 months' time, June of next year. But we still won't be ready then, or not ready in a sense that I can guarantee success. Right now we have built up sufficient attack ships and Cal missiles to hit the Salvation of Life hard enough to force it back down the wormhole. What we don't have yet is the ability to hit the current crop of city siege ships as well.
Do we need to?
Ainsley the Third asked.
It's part of the plan, Yuri said reasonably.
Not really, Danuta countered. It's a hugely desirable part of the plan, sure. But the core is to get you inside the Olyix enclave. Everything else is secondary to that objective.
Our Trojan mission and the Exodus habitats, Yuri said. Both parts have to work for the plan to have any meaning. And frankly, we're just the cherry on the cake.
What will happen with the cities if we do force the Salvation to retreat sometime in the next week? Kandara queried. There must be a contingency plan.
Not a plan specifically, Johnston said. More a calculation. If we do hit the Salvation of Life hard enough, and in the right way, we're hopeful the deliverance ships on Earth will launch and try to get into the wormhole before the Olyix close it behind them. For any that are left, we use every warship we have to chase them all the way to hell. Any that don't leave, well, that means they're an easy target.
You'll let nukes off in Earth's atmosphere? Seriously?
What's left of Earth's atmosphere? Sure. If that's what it takes to end their attack, they've ruined our world. Even if we started to re-terraform it tomorrow, it would take millennia to recover just to the stage where we could start to regenerate the biosphere, and probably longer than that for the polar ice cap to reform. As for glaciers, that's for our great-great-great-grandchildren.
I don't think the five of us can really concern ourselves with Earth anymore, Yuri said.
What happens to Earth and the Exodus habitats after we leave is what happens. We just need to concentrate on getting our part right.
That's brutal, Callum protested. 83 cities have fallen since the siege started, thanks to screw-ups, crap maintenance, and sabotage. Yuri replied,
that's practically one a week. Our life is brutal now. And it's never going to get better. Not for us.
You need to face that.
Yeah, fuck you too, pal. We only get one shot at this, so it has to be right. No, it has to be perfection. You were on that test light. We were mediocre at best.
But it worked, Kandara said. We flew. First time out. The equipment works. We worked. So the rest of us aren't as good as Jessica when it comes to piloting. But we sure as hell function as a team. And precision piloting isn't half as critical as the rest of the mission coming together.
Okay, Amelia said. Do any of the five of you have a substantial doubt that you can get into the Salvation of Life if we initiate strike back?
If he was being honest with himself, Callum had to admit his doubts were all down to nerves. There were so many interlocking factors, every one of which had to play out perfectly, and the stakes were insane.
But, yeah, I think we can do it. He looked around at Loy and Eldland.
What about you two? Your role is pretty damn essential. Find us an Olyix transport ship in the right place, and we'll be fine, Loy said.
General, Ainsley III asked, the Olyix transport ships are always on the move, but we can track them. If one is on course for a suitable position, we'll know.
Any possibilities coming up?
Yes. Unfortunately, two of the Salt Lake City shield generators are losing efficiency. It looks like minor component burnout. They all have multiple redundancy built in, of course, but the tolerances are getting close to redline levels.
Surely that's a simple replacement issue, Danuta said.
Maybe, but the fact that two generators are glitching at the same time is suspicious. We have replacement generators scheduled, but we're also worried about Paris and London.
More sabotage?
Yes, Sochko said. Nikolai's team has infiltrated a shield generator compound in London. They launched creeper drones, which have chewed their way into the generator auxiliary systems. In Paris, Edouard's people have almost penetrated the perimeter to the power supply portal from New Washington. So we can expect a concentration of transport ships outside those three cities over the next few days.
For Christ's sake, Danuta protested.
If we know about the sabotage teams, we need to exterminate them. And I still can't believe anyone is dumb or desperate enough to work for an Olyix agent.
This is the problem we face right from the start, Alex said. We can't let the Olyix know we're plugged into the salvation of life's one mind. And if we start taking out their operatives on Earth, they'll realize quickly enough.
Yeah, but people helping them? That's fucking disgusting.
Most of the sabotage is carried out by drones and synth creatures, Yuri said. The dark market suppliers don't realize what their products are being used for.
I still think we should take them out. We know all of them by now, don't we? So what if the One Mind realizes?
It might affect our Trojan flight,
Jessica said. We need to be able to fool the One Mind about the identity of the avenging heretic. We cannot risk it discovering that we can perceive its thought stream and, by implication, deceive it.
But we can't let more cities fall. Damn it, Berlin was bad. Nobody expected that. The people trapped under those shields need some good news.
We're looking for other angles to come at the Olyix agents, Alex said. If there's another way, we'll find it.
The strike back will be the greatest news possible, Emilia said.
For a while, Ainsley III observed. It'll take a few years to dawn on the population that they're never going to leave. All we're doing, supplying them with food and power, is keeping them alive for the Olyix to cocoon.
If we can destroy the Olyix enclave before they return to Earth,
Danuta trailed off.
Sorry, it's just losing is too big to accept.
Short-term loss, Yuri said. Long-term gain. A cold equation, but ultimately everyone that the Olyix cocoon will return home.
I sincerely hope so,
Emilia said.
General, how long will it take you to launch strike back?
3 days to prepare. Then it all depends on the position of Olyux transport ships.
It only takes one to be in the right place,
Edlund said.
We'll find it.
And the five of you, Ainsley III said, in an unusually sober voice. This is not a mission you can be asked or ordered to perform. Are you still willing to undertake it?
Fucking A,
Kandara said.
The greatest spy mission in the history of the universe?
Alec chuckled. Try to stop me. Exhortation, organization, and reprisals, Yuri said. I will enjoy implementing that last. Callum exaggerated a sigh.
Someone with a brain has to keep an eye on this lot.
Everyone turned to stare at Jessica.
It will be an honor to fly with you, she said,
then grinned at Kandara.
Who knows? It might finally qualify me as human.
Interstellar Space. Year 2, AA, after arrival. It took the massive fabrication station 7 months to extrude the Sisaket habitat, a hollow cylinder 35 kilometers long and 8 in diameter, with a sunlight spindle stretched along the axis. When it was powered up, the spindle's radiance matched the spectrum of a G-class star, shining across an interior of sculpted hills and meandering valleys that idealized the rolling countryside of Central Europe. Streams ran the length of the cylinder, slowly thickening as they wound between lakes of varying sizes, fed from twice-weekly night rains. Once germinated, the fledgling biosphere progressed fruitfully, greening the sandy soil and giving the atmosphere the warmth and humidity of late spring. Delian breathed it in as he stepped out of the portal just a couple of kilometers from the end cap.
"Is this temperature correct?"
"Yes," Yarella chuckled. "You're just spoiled from living in tropical climates all the time." He shivered and made a show of zipping up his jacket as he surveyed the view. They'd emerged near the top of a small grassy hill, crowned by a cluster of elegant houses. The newness of the habitat's biosphere was striking. There wasn't a single plant taller than a meter high, as if someone had given the green landscape a buzz cut. Different shades of green mottled the ground as far as he could see. Saplings of proto-forest on the slopes fashioned dark green wave lines, undulating down into the emerald grasslands of the valley floors. 2 kilometers away, the blank, near vertical end cap, rose upward like a cliff at the end of the universe. They walked along the track to Alessandra's house, a building cut into the hill, with a broad shingle roof and walls that were mostly big windows, separated by solid sections of wood plank. A long balcony ran across the front, giving a direct view of the domineering end cap.
"Nice?"
he asked cautiously. Yarella shrugged. Plenty of people were gathering at the house, and Delian knew most of them. All the binaries who'd grown up on the Immerli estate back on Juloss, or at least those who'd survived the fateful strike at Vean 2 years ago. How many they'd lost still took some getting used to. Mingling with them were Omnia, who'd been on the Calabar when it was ambushed by the Olyix. They found Alessandre on the terrace, a tall glass of sparkling rosé in her hand. Delian couldn't remember ever seeing her drinking before and didn't quite know how to react. Disapproval would seem like disrespect, and that was something he would never allow to happen. Alessandre's apparent youth didn't help his attitude either. She now looked positively adolescent, thanks to her rebuilt body. In fact, Delian had a sneaking suspicion he might now look the older of the two. If Alessandre was as perturbed by the age switch, she didn't show it. She gave them both a warm hug.
"Thank you for coming. I need people who'll ground me." "Happy housewarming,"
Yarella said.
"Sweet saints, a housewarming."
She shook her head in bemusement.
"I never imagined I'd have a housewarming. It seems so final. Like, this is it. You're never going to move on from this. It's your peak in life."
"Nonsense," Delian said. "This is the start of your new life. That's why we're celebrating it."
"Thank you. But I was quite happy with my old life."
"So was everyone on Earth before the Olyix came."
"Ouch. Who's the teacher now?"
"I didn't mean..." But Alessandre was chortling. So Delian grinned weakly and used his data bud to call a server remote over, one loaded with plenty of alcohol.
"How are you coping?"
Yarella asked.
"Physically, I mean." "To be honest, I'm not sure,"
Alessandre admitted. "Most of this new body was grown outside the biologic initiator, which gives me a sense of, I don't know, imposter syndrome?"
"But your brain is still 100% original," she insisted.
"I know. One of the big original human fantasies, right? Having your time over. But there's got to be a lot of senescent cells left up here."
She tapped her head. "I guess wisdom and caution rule over impetuosity after all. I know I can run up mountains, but despite the urging of fizzing hormones, I just don't particularly want to."
"That's psychology, not physiology. We're all still in a state of shock and depression. You from when the Olyix intercepted the Calabar and cocooned the lot of you. Us from being ambushed at Vian, when we thought we were the ones ambushing them. I can't conceive of a greater, more humiliating failure than that."
"Oh, my dear, no,"
C protested. "That's so far from where we are. We have these splendid new habitats to live in safely, and all of us, rescued from the Calabar, have been rebodied. What could be better for morale than that?"
"That's just a short-term feeling,"
Yarella said. "In reality, the foundation of our whole strike mission has been wrecked. The Olyix knew everything we planned to do, and they fooled us completely. They knew about our Exodus habitats and worked out the limits of our expansion into the galaxy. They knew what to look for and where. They found us. I can't believe the effort they must have dedicated to pursuing us. It's almost impossible in a galaxy as vast as this one. But they did it. They are hubris to our arrogance. Saints. We built an entire fake civilization on Vian as a lure. It was so real, it even convinced the Niana. Yet it was all pointless. We wasted years and took a terrible beating at the end of it. If it hadn't been for Ainsley turning up, we'd be in the cocoons next to you. There is no failure greater than that.
Delian laughed.
What?
Yurella said. Ever wonder why we don't get invited to many parties?
Ever wonder why she puts up with you?
Alessandra taunted.
Because I haven't got a clue.
A server remote trundled up to them, and Yurella snagged a glass of wine.
Here's to a future relived, and relived properly.
They drank to that.
Double celebration,
Alessandra said. This is also the day when the last of the Calabar personnel walked out of medical.
273,853 successfully de-cocooned,
Yurella said, and only 103 casualties.
They were very old,
Delian said sadly.
I know the feeling,
Alessandra said.
This is a quite surreal experience I'm undergoing.
I have a young body, and when I woke up, there you all were. Everyone who grew up in the Emerly estate, decades after I waved a final goodbye to you.
What are the odds?
Delian groaned. You had to ask.
Not as long as everyone is presuming,
Yurella said. The Olyix sensor station was only 20 light years from Vian. It covered a bubble of space 500 light years in diameter. So actually, it's surprising the Calabar was the only generation ship they'd captured.
There were several flying away from Juloss that must still be inside their operational range. But I'm glad it was you.
How do you know where their sensor station is? Alessandra asked.
Ainsley told us. He extracted the coordinates out of the Olyix ship's one mind when he found the gateway location.
I still can't get my head around that. Ainsley Zangari, an alien warship.
A mostly human warship, and a huge bonus for us.
Is he? Really?
We've already started retro-engineering some of his weapons technology.
Trying to retro-engineer. Some of that mysterious creator technology is beyond anything we know, or even understand.
They're called the Katos,
Yurella corrected primly,
and it's not just their technology. The Angelis and the Niana were part of the factory, too.
Allegedly.
I mean, do we actually have any proof? About the alien species? No. Apart from the fact Ainsley must have been made somewhere. And he's definitely on our side.
Thank the saints. Her hand went out to rest on Delian's shoulder.
He saved Del, too.
You saved me, Delian said, and lifted her hand up to kiss it.
You too,
Alessandra said thickly. You'll get me all weepy. That's a curse of a young body.
It's too emotional.
Yurella grinned.
Again, psychology, not physiology. You don't get to blame emotions on your body. They're all yours.
Alessandra put her arms around both of them.
Sense, bless you.
Neither of you have changed.
How strange.
You've become my rock now.
That might become a cyclic thing if we all wind up using biologic initiators to body rebuild,
Yurella said.
You mean become immortal?
Alessandra said.
Yeah,
Delian said. How come nobody did that on Juloss?
There are plenty of people who did that back on Juloss,
C replied. Some who came on the founding generation ship were still alive to leave 500 years later. However, given our life expectancy is around 250 years, many citizens felt that was long enough for them. I don't know if it's a valid factor, but the majority of those who rejuve come from the early days of the Exodus. I suspect it's a comment on the societies we build on the new worlds, that they don't inspire as many to live even longer.
I didn't know rejuvenation was common,
Yurella said.
It used to be common. Remember, you lived at the end of our time on Juloss.
Most of the population had flown.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.